sequin, all right? So let me look at an example, and I think this will help motivate this idea. Let's look at a number line, shall we? And let me take, associated with this point, say it's the number 0, and way over here someplace, let me now select the number 1. And midway between these two points, we know that we have this point, and associated with that point is a number which we will call, what? 1/2. And then let me select a point midway between 1/2 and 1, and associated with this point is the number 3/4. And then between these two points, let me then select another point right in here, say, and associated with that point is the number, and I think you would agree that it would be what? 7/8. And then, in fact, I'm getting a little crowded here, but associated with this point then, let's say, is the number, what? 15/16, and I think that's far enough. Let's write down some of these terms of this sequence, and notice here we have then the number 1/2, and then 3/4, and 7/8, and 15/16, and so on. Now, just looking at this sequence and looking at our picture here, as this sequence goes on and on and on forever, what then do you think the value of the sequence is getting closer and closer and closer to? And just looking at it, what's your intuition tell you, Bill?
1.
It's getting closer to 1. Alright? Now let's write this sequence in a slightly different pattern. Let me write it as 1 − 1/2 to the 1 power. That's our first term. Alright? 1 − 1/2 is still 1/2. Let me then write the second term as 1 − 1/2 squared, and 1/2 squared is 1/4, and 1 − 1/4 is 3/4, so that sure enough is our second term. 1 − 1/2 cubed would be the third term, and let's continue this on out to some term of 1 − and let me write it as 1/2 to the nth power, that would be the nth term, and in fact, let me continue this sequence on forever. Okay? Now, again, let me ask the same question. As the sequence goes on forever, what then can we say about the number that this is approaching? And it's getting closer and closer again to, Rick says, to 1. And the way in which we say that, there's a nice mathematical way in which we write this, in which we say the limit of 1 − 1/2 to the nth power as n approaches infinity, all right, this little infinity symbol, which I think you've seen before, is then equal to a number. And in this case, the number is 1, okay? And when we have a sequence which has a limit, all right, when a sequence exists which has a limit, then we give that kind of sequence a special name, and it is called a convergence, C-O-N-V-E-R-G-E-N-C. It's called a convergent sequence, all right? So this sequence that we have here certainly converges. Well, let's continue to look at this sequence. Let me write it down again. And notice now that 1/2 is certainly less than or equal to 3/4, which is less than or equal to 7/8, which is less than or equal to 15/16, and so on. Is that right? In which each term is less than or equal to the next term. And when we have a sequence of this pattern, in fact, the absolute value of each term is less than or equal to some of the next term, okay, we then call this sequence a special name, and because it is increasing, we could call it an increasing sequence, but to account for the possibility in which the terms are the same, because I have here the less than or equal to symbol, the name that we give it is not an increasing sequence, but rather, Glenn, a non-decreasing sequence, a non-decreasing sequence. So let's include this word here. And in fact, there's another idea that we may consider, and notice that each one of these terms can be thought of as being less than or equal to some number. And give me some number in which every term here in this sequence is going to be less than or equal to. And Rick says 1. And in fact, any other number that each term, in fact, the absolute value of each term is less than or equal to what number? And Rick says 1 and 4. In fact, there are lots of numbers. 2 would be a number in which each term is absolute value would be less than or equal to 2, and so on. And when this is the case, we give the sequence another name, and which we call it bounded. Okay? So here we have an example of a bounded, non-decreasing sequence which converges. That is, it has a limit. Okay? There are a lot of words here, but I think that the idea is quite straightforward, and we're looking at it rather from an intuitive point of view, and not being very precise and exact, in which this idea of limit can be, by the way. Well, let's call this then, this whole idea, the limit of a sequence, right? And what I'd like to do is to look at another example or two, and perhaps from that we will look at some sequences which perhaps are not convergent. For example, suppose you look at 1, comma, negative 1, comma, 1, comma, negative 1, and so on. Now, just looking at this sequence, do you think that it has a limit? As n goes on forever here, is there some number that this sequence is approaching? Is it getting closer and closer and closer to some number? No, it's just jumping back and forth between 1 and negative 1, and I think you'll agree here that this sequence does not have a limit, and the word that we use to describe that is called a divergent. A divergent sequence, okay? D-I-V-E-R-G-E-N-T. It's a divergent sequence. And here's an example of a divergent sequence. However, again, let's consider the absolute value of each one of our terms here. And is there some number which is going to be bigger than the absolute value of every one of these terms? Is there some number that you can give me in which absolute value of every term here is less than or equal to that number? And Don says, yes, 2 would be certainly a number which would satisfy that. So this sequence is still a bounded sequence, but it diverges. Okay? Let's look at another example. Well, suppose we had 2 to the 1 power, 2 to the 2 power, 2 cubed, and so on out to 2 to the nth power. Now, looking at this example here, as n goes on forever, is there some number that the sequence is approaching? Is it getting closer and closer to some number? As n goes on out to infinity, what then is happening to each term? Is it doing, it's doing what? It's getting larger and larger. So what then is your conclusion? Is this a convergent or a divergent sequence? And you would say that it is what? Well, remember now, it converges if it has a limit. And does this sequence have a limit? Does it get closer and closer to one number? No, so therefore our conclusion is that it is a divergent sequence, okay? And in fact, is there some number such that the absolute value of every one of these terms is less than or equal to that number? No. And I think you would say no, so therefore this sequence is what? Let's call it not bounded. Not bounded. Okay. Well, let's look at a fourth example. And again, let me make another picture. Oh, this time again, let me take 0 here and 1 way out there. And let me pick out a point, say, right about here, which is associated with that point, say, is 1/3. And then let me pick some point, say, right about in here, and associated with this point would be, let me call it 1/9. And then somewhere in here, I have associated with this point, I can't put it in there, so let me call it 1/27. And now I'm writing the sequence of the pattern, 1/3, comma. In fact, let me write it as 1/3 squared, comma, 1/3 cubed, is that right? And so on up to some term of 1/3 to the nth power, and continuing on forever. Now, what can you say about this sequence? Looking at our picture, we see that our points are getting closer and closer to what number? To 0. And looking at our sequence here, as n goes to infinity, 1/3 to the nth power is getting closer and closer to 0. So in fact, we may then write using our symbolism that the limit of 1/3 to the nth power as n goes to infinity is equal to, notice it is equal to, and what is that number? It's equal to 0. And here's a sequence then which is what? There are 2 words here that are important that we're looking at. This sequence certainly, Tom, is convergent. Okay, if it has a limit, then it converges, or is convergent. And it's also bounded, okay? So here we have a convergent and bounded sequence, okay? And in fact, let's look at this, let me repeat that. There's 1/3, which is, we know, greater than or equal to 1/9, which is greater than or equal to 1/27, which is greater than or equal to 1/81, and so on. Now, as in our first example, the sequence was what? Non-decreasing. Here then is a sequence which you may call non-increasing. So we have a non-increasing sequence which is convergent and bounded. Okay? Now, here are 4 examples, and notice of the 4 we have 2 of them which are convergent and are bounded, all right? And therefore, what we will say is to, what we'd like to do is to make an assumption. And there's a very good reason why we want to make this assumption, and we'll go into that in a few minutes. But let's just indicate what that statement is, okay? And we call this an axiom, and it's one of the last axioms that we need to have for our real numbers. It's called the axiom of completeness, all right? The axiom of completeness. And let's look at our examples here and see how we can motivate this. And notice in each case, we have a convergent bounded sequence, which is either non-increasing or non-decreasing, okay? So the assumption that we'll make is that every sequence which is bounded, okay, and non-increasing or non-decreasing must do what? What do you think it must do?
Mm-hmm.
It must converge, okay? And in fact, its limit is going to always be a real number. So let's write this down, in which we have every bounded, B-O-U-N-D-E-D, every bounded non-increasing, all right? Well, let me put it in parentheses, which we may also have a non-decreasing, all right, sequence of real numbers, all right? It's a sequence of real numbers. And what then can we say about every bounded non-increasing or non-decreasing sequence of real numbers? It does what? It must, Brenda? It must converge. It converges. It converges. And let's include this. And its limit. And its limit is what? What can we say, Bill?
A real number.
It is a real number. Okay. Now, let's see where this axiom here, this assumption that we're making, is really going to help us. For example, suppose I were to look at, let me take a sequence. The first element is 3. The second element is 3.1. The third element is 3.14. 3.141. 3.1415, 3.14159, and so on, okay? Now, let me call this first element here, the first term of the sequence, a sub 1, here we have a sub 2, a sub 3, and so on, all the way out here to a sub n, and so on, forever, all right? Now, looking at this sequence, is it a non-decreasing or a non-increasing sequence? It is what? It is non-decreasing, all right? It certainly is non-decreasing. Does this sequence have a bound? Is there a number such that the absolute value of every term is less than or equal to that, to this one? And what then? Give me a bound. Any bound. Four would be a perfectly acceptable bound. Therefore, this assumption says that this sequence has a limit, all right? And in fact, the limit is a real number. So let's write it then as the limit of a sub n as n goes to infinity. I'm going to use this symbolism here, all right? And what, Ben, do you think that this limit is? What do you think it must be equal to? Looking at the pattern that I have established here, what kind of number, what number does that look like, Michael? It looks like pi. It looks like pi. And in fact, that's exactly what it is. Now, why do we want to include this assumption right here, this axiom right here, and not have it earlier? Well, I think what we need to do is to look at what we mean by the set of real numbers again, okay? And you remember way back in chapter 1, I believe it was, we had those axioms which we call the axioms of, the field axiom. Let me just put this word in parentheses. Remember the field axiom, in which we had 11 of those properties, and you remember what they were? We started out, if you recall, with closure, with respect to addition and also multiplication. And then we had, what was another set of properties of axioms? The commutative, C-O-M-M, let me just abbreviate here, with respect to addition and also with respect to multiplication. And then another one that we had was what? The associative. Let me just abbreviate again, with respect to addition and multiplication. And then we had another pair of axioms. Before that, we had identity elements, the existence of identity elements. Let me just write down the word identity elements with respect to what? Addition and multiplication. What was the identity element for addition?
Zero.
The identity element for multiplication?
One.
And then once we had identity elements, that gave us inverse elements, all right? We had then the inverse elements. And there's an inverse element with respect to addition and also with respect to multiplication. For every number A, what's the inverse of A?
Negative.
The opposite of A. For every number A not zero, the multiplicative inverse is
one
over A. And then finally, we had one other property that tied the two operations together, which is called a distributive property, the distributive axiom of what? Multiplication over addition, all right? And if we were to count these up, we had 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, and one property is 11 field axioms, okay? Now, then in chapter 2, I believe it was, we then looked at those axioms called the order axioms, all right? And if you remember, we had a comparison axiom. And what did the comparison axiom say? For any two real numbers, A and B, A is what? Less than B, or A equals B, or A is greater than B. That's our comparison axiom. And then we had a transitivity axiom, a transitive axiom, which says what? If A is less than B, we may use it either, there are two halves to it, less than and greater than. Say, let's talk about the less than one. If A is less than B, and if what?
B
is less than C, then A is less than C. That's our transitive axiom with respect to order. We had some addition axiom, which says that if A is less than B, then for every real number C, what is our conclusion? Brenda? A plus C is less than B plus C. And then we also had some multiplication axiom. All right, and if A is less than B, then if C, say, is positive, all right, C is greater than zero, what is our conclusion? And Tom? A times C is less than B times C. Now, looking at these order axioms and the field axioms, is there some set of numbers which we have also been dealing with that will satisfy all of these that you can think of offhand? Bill? The rational number. Everything that we have written down here will satisfy the set of rational numbers. In other words, they do not, these properties here do not characterize the real numbers. And what then is the distinguishing characteristic, the distinguishing property between the rational numbers and the real numbers? And it's this completeness axiom. So as soon as I put down the third axiom here, which is our completeness axiom, okay, we now have defined uniquely that set of numbers which we will call what? The set of real numbers. So let's put that up here as a heading. And we have now the complete description, so to speak, with respect to these axioms, with respect to these properties of the real numbers. Okay? Well, I think that's all that we should do today. So let me give you your assignment. This will be assignment number